honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air number 137 on Collective Kamma and on Buddhist intuition and other issues pertaining to the true Dhamma. Thank you for your attention and welcome here.
Friends, the Four Noble Truths, Dhatarya, Arya, Satyani, which is the very core of Buddhism, are: 1. All this and such is suffering, dukkha. 2. Craving is the cause of suffering, Samudaya. 3. Absence of all craving is the end of suffering, Dukkha Nirodho. 4. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to the end of suffering, Dukkha Nirodha Gamini Patipada. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nibbana is simply this: right view, Sammaditti; right motivation, Samma Sankappa; right speech, Samma Vajja; right action, Samma Kamanta; right livelihood, Samma Ajiva; right effort, Samma Vajjama; right awareness, Samma Sati; and right concentration, Samma Samadhi. What is right motivation? What is this vital right motivation? Right motivation is triple. 1. The motivation for withdrawal, nekamma, is being motivated by a general absence of greed, craving and desire, being motivated by a generous giving, relinquishing all possessiveness, being motivated by detachment from the five sense desires of urge for alluring, captivating and tempting sights, sounds, smells, tastes and touches, being motivated for cutting attachment, clinging to these five clusters of clinging, to all forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions and consciousness. Such radical renunciation is right motivation. Two, the motivation for non-ill will, which is the same as friendly goodwill, is being motivated by universal friendliness, infinite goodwill, kind care, non-anger, non-hate, non-aversion, and a sympathy, well-wishing, and working for all sentient beings' happiness, contentment, comfort, benefit and welfare. Such gentle, active kindness is right motivation. 3. the motivation for total non-violence, absolute harmlessness, is. Being motivated by absolute non-violence, by absence of all cruelty, and by presence, continuous presence of compassionate pity, thereby offering all sentient beings guaranteed safety and protection from any evil, painful, bad, or wrong treatment. Such offer a full protective fearlessness to all beings is right motivation. The opposites of these advantageous intentions are wrong motivation. Right motivation, Samma Sankappa, is enunciated in Majjhima Nikaya number 117, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha number 117, the Maha Chatta Risakha Sutta, the Discourse on the Great 40. This and such is right motivation. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 137 on collective karma or not, and Buddhist situation and other issues. And you are indeed welcome here. There are usual, as usual, three questions. But first, we're going to take the normal intro. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Erhverdig, fuldstændig komplet og perfekt selvoplyst, var den velsignede Buddha. And again in English, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. So, we are here in late summer in Denmark, in the Værhøj Forest. We've been here before. Always nice to be outside and speak the Dhamma under the trees, just like our teacher, the blessed Buddha Gautama, did for 40 years. Question 386 goes, it's on the, along the line of collective karma. One should assume that Buddhist countries would increase in population and wealth, while fundamentalist countries or war-plagued countries, conflict-plagued countries would decrease in population and wealth. Yet we see the opposite. Why so? I don't think actually you see the opposite. You cannot say that there's any particular group that gain in population and wealth compared to others. If you look at it, the statistics is not clear. If you look at, for example, with a lot of Buddhist China, this is a country that increase in population and wealth. So I don't think you can extrapolate in that way. The second thing is collective karma. Is there collective karma? Yes and no. Strictly speaking, then karma is only returning to the actor itself, or him or herself. So one cannot share karma with others. But it looks like that when everybody do the same from the same views. That is to say, if everybody says it's good to give to the poor, then they give to the poor, then everybody will get rich. It's not because they share the karma, but it's because they share views. And when they share views, then they also share action stemming from these views. In this case, right views. This also goes if it was wrong views, for example. So one cannot say that. Then also there is an enormous delay, that there can be a delay of one generation or two generations, one life or two lives. This means that the effects we see today in among cultures and among people today is something that is at least 60 years delayed, and maybe even more. So it can be also much more. So we don't know which cultures did this and that. Third thing is that one thing is the culture, what the culture says, whether Christian or Buddhist or whatever. Another thing is what people actually do in this particular country, in this particular culture. It is mental actions, verbal actions, and physical actions that actually counts. It's not what religious affiliation you have embroidered in your culture. Though this, of course, kind of like is this which religion, which philosophy, which ethical standards you have in a given country, it spills over into the laws. But if the laws are not kept, and if there's no juridical system and no police system and so on to keep up the laws, well, then it doesn't matter much. So strictly speaking, it is the behavior of the individual, and thereby summed up by many individuals. It is true that in a country, then individuals will tend to do the same. But in any country, in my country, in your country, whatever country, there's a large diversity of behavior. And within the single individual, there's over one lifetime also a large diversity in behavior. So in general, everything is mixed karma. We do both good, bad, and neutral karma over an entire life. And this also goes for cultures. And therefore, we'll have mixed results of pleasure, pain, and neutral feeling, according to the karma we did in a former life, summed up with even former lives, and summed up with what we did in the past in this life. All this together summed up, good and bad and neutral summed up, will then give a resultant effect that can be either successful, failure, or neutral, or can be either pleasure, pain, or neutral feeling. So one cannot, it's very, actually the Buddha said that if one should delineate the exact cause from action to result of action on the individual level, then it will be impossible. It's only possible for Buddhas. This is some of their dasabala, some of their 10 powers. It is that they can see the effect of any given action. If one, this particular individual do this and that, what will then happen to him or her? And if they see an effect, this effect happened to this and that person at this at that time, then it was caused by this and that action, this and that karma in a prior time. So this is particular to Buddhas. This only Buddhas can see. If as common individuals, putuyanas, ordinary individuals, they try to see the same, then either being confused follows, or madness. So this confusion is because of this complexity of the karma, because there's so many factors that goes into it. So it's not only one karma, it's crossing karmas. And also there's the aspect of when it ripens, when it becomes mature, which also depends upon the context, both in time and space and in other actions one have done, and what surroundings one is in, what other people there are in, what karma that will fit their karmic probability distribution for what, how they will behave. So it is a complex thing. So again, there is no collective karma, but it can look like that when many people do the same from the same views, whether good or bad. Then they will experience similar effects, and that look like collective karma. But it is still individual karma that is just the same or very similar. Then it looks like collective karma on the surface. Question B, one can often sense from afar that someone is angry at one. How is that possible? Yes, again, I think one can understand the Dhamma better if one goes to quantum mechanics and then see what quantum mechanics says about matter and energy. And it basically says that any particle can have two aspects, one that is non-local, that is smeared out over a large portion of space, and one that is local, that has a particle aspect that has a specific location. And so also, if one calculates or uses this picture of local and non-local at the same time, also for mind, for any piece of information, then this also goes for consciousness. Now this means consciousness has a local aspect that is collected in the brain, and seems to be an ego when looked from outside. So it has a specific perspective, it is local, it can only see out of eyes and hear out of ears within a very narrow spatial
roominess. So it's very local, so to speak. It cannot look on the other side of the moon. However, if it's a field of consciousness, just like a field of gravity or a field of light or a field of radio waves, then it will also be distended over a large portion of space. And this means if there is an angry person at another place, then once there will be some of his or her consciousness at in some of his or her non-local, everywhere present consciousness present in one's mind. And this one will be able to register it, because the information there, to whether angry or lovable or kind or generous or whatever, this information will be present in one's mind. So that's basically why. I told a story before. I will tell it again because I once experienced this very powerful. My grandma, which was 2 miles away in a high-rise house, suddenly experienced danger. And I could not see her, I could not hear her. But I experienced this danger very acutely in my garden where I was, and then stormed up to her. And so if you ask me at that particular moment, how could you sense that your grandma was in danger? I have no idea. I could just sense I had to visit her very, just now. And when I came up to her, she fainted right into my arms. So this is an aspect. Her consciousness was also where I was located. And so my consciousness is also, to some extent, where you are located, with a very, very wild field strength, which is gradually reduced by the square of the distance from. But nevertheless, if there is a good coherence, then one will still be able to sense it. So intuition, Buddhist intuition, is simply one can pick up information that is everywhere present. And this means that the non-local information of all beings' consciousness traverse space and thereby convey this information of what mental state this consciousness is in at particular moment. And this is very variable information. It's not because one should be angry for because of that. One can use it skillfully as any other information and say, if this person is angry, then one should be metta towards them. And beam kindness, universal kindness and friendliness, forgiveness, generosity towards them. So one will feel that this anger fizzles out, and one can feel it in one's heart. So it is, one can use this information skillfully, very skillfully. The last question goes like this: how to deal with paranoia? And question B is: can paranoia be beneficial? How to deal with paranoia? Yeah, the best thing is to look at it, just look at it, and see it pass away. Ah, there is your paranoia again. And kind of like face it, take it the bull by the horns, and say, can it really be true? Or is it crazy? Crazy thought. And then one will see, when one checks up the information afterwards, and checks up whether this person or that person meant this and that, and whether this or that action actually was there, then one will see, but this was not true. This is not true. This is not the case. And then one will come to experience, suddenly one realizes, this was one's own anger, one's own fear that was brewing up this paranoia. Can it be beneficial? Well, I would say in general it's not very beneficial, but it can be beneficial in any case to see a very provocative state of mind, whether it's paranoia, whether it's jealousy, whether it's anger, whether it's strong greed, whether it's fear, whatever. Just one looks at it and sees it, recognizes it as it is. Now this mind is in fear. Now this mind is in paranoia. Now this mind is not in paranoia. Now this mind is liberated from greed, hate and ignorance, if that is the case. Now this mind is at ease. Now this mind is tired. Now this mind is alert, and so on. It's just registered. So any kind of mental state that the mind sees, when mind sees mind, this is the end of suffering. When mind goes out of mind and do not see mind, like in a mirror, then it starts to become suffering. Why so? Because mind is still working, it's still crunching about on the mental defilements of greed, hate and ignorance, and all kinds of other stuff that comes up from greed, hate and ignorance, such as fear, and then paranoia, and then restlessness, regret, worries, speculation and so forth. So seeing mind seeing mind, in whatever state it is beneficial. But one cannot say in itself that paranoia is beneficial. Another thing is there's a strong component of fear in paranoia. How to overcome fear? Yeah, there's a classic meditation method in early Buddhist thought that is called asupa, and that is skeleton meditation or meditation on corpses, where one stays meditating on scanning one's own skeleton or imagining one's own body as a corpse. When one is imagining one's own body as a corpse, then one becomes fearless of death. Since fear of death is the highest fear, then one gradually loses all fear. Because if you don't fear death, you don't fear anything. If you don't fear, then it's difficult to have paranoia. So this is one of the methods to gain fearlessness. In general, it is method. Buddha, he many times slept on a cemetery, and this is also one of the early Buddhist practices, to sleep on a cemetery where he uses a skeleton head, a skull, as his pillow. And there he was not afraid, and he lost his fear. Even though there could be ghosts and so on haunting the place, and there could be wild dogs, there could be hyenas, vultures that came to feed on the corpses. In old days, cemeteries in India, sometimes it is still like that, the corpses are not digged down, they're just lied there, put there, wrapped up in clothes. And they're not burned or anything, they just lie on the surface of the earth. And so it can be a rough place to be. But imagine just being in a forest like this. I've been many times in the tropics, staying out there in the forest at night and sleep, and all the sounds from the animals, can be elephants, can be leopards, can be water buffaloes, monkeys, whatever, and you don't know the sounds, and they can be very challenging. But you often survive fairly easy, and then you learn something about this fear, because you went through it and saw it was nothing. Often one can have a torch, and when some animal comes closer, and one sees, it's just a deer, or it's just this and that. One says, it's just like this and that. And then there's no fear left. Subscribing here is a ticket to Nirvana, so remember to click subscribe down there, and if you already are subscribed, then also click the bell down there, and thumbs up if you like these videos. Questions are well sent to Bhikkhu Samahita, whatbuddhasaid.net, or Bhante Samahita, bhante.samahita@gmail.com. And so send in your questions, especially can be a private nature. There will of course not be mentioned any names, so anyone is anonymous. But usually they have a general import, these private questions, because everybody has the same problems more or less in samsara. And lastly, I'd like to also introduce that there are two meditation courses in USA coming up. You can see them on my website, whatbuddhasaid.net. They are in on Theosophical Society in near Chicago, and then in North Carolina in Henderson. There will be a 4-day on universal friendliness, and then there will be also one in Woodstock in Illinois on also the four infinite divine abidings, the four Brahma Vihara, which is again metta, universal loving kindness, friendliness, goodwill, which is karuna, compassion, pity, feeling with empathy, which is mudita, mutual joy, rejoicing joy, feeling joy in others' success, and upekka, equanimity, imperturbability, serenity, the thing that one cannot be disturbed. With these words, and before the rain comes, I would like to say thank you for your advantageous attention. Thank you also for your clever consideration, and even more thank you for your kind contribution. If you like to contribute to this Dhamma sharing, then go to whatbuddhasaid.net, and there you can contribute via PayPal, or you can go to my Patreon site, Patreon Samahita, which is both linked on the YouTube site and whatbuddhasaid.net, and you are indeed welcome to do that. Lastly, but not leastly, we'll take the intro again. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed. Thank you.
Friends, the Four Noble Truth, Chatari, Arya, Satyani, which is the very core of Buddhism, are the following. 1. All this, and such is suffering, dukkha. 2. Craving is the cause of suffering, dukkha, samudaya. 3. Absence of craving is the end of suffering, dukkha, nirodha. 4. The Noble Eightfold Way leads to the end of suffering. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nibbana is simply this. Right view, sammatitti. Right motivation, sammasankappa. Right speech, sammavacca. Right action, Samma Kamanta. Right livelihood, Samma Ajiva. Right effort, Samma Vajama. Right awareness, Samma Sati. And right concentration, Samma Samadhi. But what is right view? What is this initiating and thus crucial right view? Right view is threefold. 1. Right view is of ownership of Kamma, like this. All beings are owners of the Kamma, inherit the Kamma, are born of the Kamma, are created by their Kamma, are linked to their Kamma, and any intentional action, any Kamma they do, whether good or bad, the effects of that will be theirs only, following like a shadow that never leaves. This is right view. 2. Right view of the ten phenomena is like this. Giving alms has good future effects. Any self-sacrifice results in pleasure. Small gifts and donations are also advantageous. There is resulting fruition thus of any good and any bad behavior. There's moral, ethical efficacy of any relation to mother and father. There's this world, and there are other dimensions other worlds. There are beings who are spontaneously and instantaneously reborn. There exists good and pure recluses and monks in this world, who by having followed the right method of practice, themselves, by their own superhuman abilities, have directly experienced these other worlds, and who explain them and thereby make them known here. This is right view, too. 3. Right view of the Four Noble Truths. Right view of this is suffering. Right view of craving is the cause of suffering. Right view of absence of craving is the end of suffering. Right view of the Noble Eightfold Way leading to the end of suffering. This too is right view. And for further study on right view, Majjhima Nikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, number 9, is Sammaditti Sutta, the discourse on right view. This and such is right view, Sammaditti. Thank you for your keen attention and have a nice day.